Good evening, Mademoiselle and Monsieur, for joining us at the Cotton Club. Please do enjoy our menu from 1938, printed from the annals of New York City history before you. You are looking at the menu of the Cotton Club. I have made you several dishes from the menu, which we will be eating this evening. You have the menu in front of you with the prices of the time. By the end of this meal, I want you to estimate how much money this meal would cost you in today's dollars, adjusted for inflation. First up, as an appetizer, we have... celery!
Boo!
It's just a plate of celery.
I get a nice one. Yeah.
Wow, I hate celery so much.
Why are you eating it?
Because you put it in front of me.
Well... as you'll note, that would run you 50 cents in 1938.
What about stuffed celery?
Celery is a dollar. I looked into that. That is piped cream cheese into the celery with a little bit of paprika on top. Your second course is Welsh rarebit. Welsh rarebit is a dish that is basically toast with a cheese and mustard sauce. It's a misnomer. A lot of people think it's Welsh rabbit. Well, a Welsh rarebit will run you $1.25.
I dig this.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. This would be like a nice breakfast thing. Mm. What you have here is a steak sandwich with potatoes O'Brien. I wasn't going to make the potatoes O'Brien because I ran out of potatoes, but I was at Aldi and literally, lo and behold, in the frozen case, they had potatoes O'Brien.
Get out.
Which is just potatoes with onions and
pepper.
What's
up with Aldi showing up sometimes?
Yeah.
So, what is this? What is this actually?
It's impossible meat, not beyond, with...
Beyond me.
With a caramelized onion.
Amazing. Tastes great.
And provolone cheese. On a Amoroso roll.
Mmm.
Where's our dessert?
What the hell's wrong with you two?
You're a man after my own heart,
You come
Owen.
To the Cotton Club and you lose
we
all manners?
Want dessert.
You're demanding
we
food?
We want dessert.
Is there another course?
I think both of you were raised better than this.
Okay.
Better be something good. Honestly, like, if we've been begging for dessert, you pull out, like, some, like, horse-like head or something, like...
like the Godfather?
Cannibal sandwich.
I'm gonna flip. Woo! Oh, it is the pear! It is the pear
thing!
Oh, this
looks delicious!
It is. Pears Cardinal!
Oh, yummy.
Which is pears poached in a wine sauce reduction.
Wine?
Oh, it does smell like wine.
Mm-hmm. And then
it does.
Yeah.
Mm.
Never taking you guys here again.
Oh. That's really good. I legit really like this dessert.
Yeah?
I'm like really, really digging this.
If you were a poor person, I think this would really... wet your appetite.
It's wet my appetite as a poor person now. Sorry, Owen. Like this napkin is mine now. Okay.
It's more here.
I don't need a napkin.
I do.
I have clothes for that reason.
Classy.
Just to recap, your steak sandwiches with potatoes O'Brien ran you $2.50.
Okay.
Your celery, which we enjoyed very much, was 50 cents to begin with. The Welsh rarebit.
Many men.
Ran you 1.25 cents. 75 cents for the Paris Cardinal. Mm. Altogether, $5 in 1938, this meal. So how much do you think that would be in 2023 dollars? Go ahead and write down your guesses. Owen, you drew a cool guy with, I guess, a helmet on?
Fro.
$19 was Owen's guess. Sarah, you guessed $25.
Whoa.
The correct answer, adjusted for inflation, $5 in 1938 currency has the buying power of $110.11 in 2023. Would you pay $110.11 for what you just ate? Well, I have some bad news for you. You both owe me $110.11 to cover the expenses of this meal.
Are you serious?
This is Deep Dive Divas. Each episode, myself and Owen and a guest diva listen to every blessed studio album by an artist of their choosing and share our findings with
you.
Are you going to eat your pears, Owen?
Are you going to have them?
Oh, yeah.
Our guest today is Sarah. Sarah is a musician, a burlesque dancer, and a mother to two adorable little kitties. You can and should check out her music using the links in this episode's show notes.
Cab Calloway was a jazz / swing performer, dancer, and band leader. He made many records and singles in his career. So many that it's frankly impossible to really put together a comprehensive discography of his music. So we kind of had to invent one.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm. He also appeared in quite a few films and made it on the silver screen.
So
is that TV? Is TV the silver screen?
I don't know.
He was on TV as well as various staged productions on and around Broadway. He was a pioneer in virtually every medium he participated in, and he has received a whole slew of honors in and after his lifetime, including the United States Congress's National Medal of Arts, a Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award. He was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame, and his works are being added to the Library of Congress's National Recording Registry, as well as the National Film Registry.
But Minnie had a heart as big as a whale. Hidey, 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 hidey.
Hidey, 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 hidey.
Sarah, why did you choose Cab Calloway?
Well, I wrote this whole paper on him for my degree and realized that he's just like so much of a big deal that it's alarming to me that people don't talk about him.
Can you tell us what degree you were going for?
My music degree.
Now, music. Could you tell us a little bit about that? Follow me back, if you will, to 1907. On Christmas Day, Cab Calloway III was brought into this world by his mother, Martha Eulalia Reed, in Rochester, New York. His mummy was a teacher and organist for her church. His papa, Cab Calloway Jr., was a lawyer and real estate agent.
Sounds like a hottie.
Yeah. They were both from Baltimore, Maryland, but Cab's dad went to Lincoln in Pennsylvania. The family lived in Rochester for 5 years and moved into a new home almost every year across that five-year expanse.
Ugh, that sounds awful.
There would eventually be five Calloway children: Bernice, Henry, Blanche, Cab, and Elmer. Blanche would go on to be a jazz singer herself. She wrote her own songs and was the first woman to front an orchestra of all men.
Get out.
Not amen, all men.
Mm.
Amen. Amen.
How unfortunate for her that she has to live in Cab's shadow.
Yes, and as we'll see, that was not always the case. Yeah. Cab very much felt that he was living in Blanche's shadow.
Wild.
So Blanche had a massive impact and influence on her younger brother with her performance style. She also hired Louis Armstrong to be a part of her band before he broke it big.
Wow.
Well, in 1913, when Cab was just 5 years old, his father passed away. According to the work of Dr. Emily Morey, a librarian with the Rochester Public Library's Local History and Genealogy Division, Cab's father's mental and physical health had been declining for years prior to his death. Often happens that way. In 1910, Cab Calloway Jr., Cab's father, appeared in the Rochester newspaper entitled The Democrat and Chronicle. weird name for a newspaper. I had to check about 8 times to make sure I had that right, and it's still in operation today in Rochester. So what happened with Cab's papa? He climbed on a pole at a Western Union Telegraph office, wrapped a bunch of the wires running into the building around its chimney, and then propelled himself through the skylight of the Columbia Rifle Club's kitchen.
Why?
Because he was losing his damn mind.
Really?
Yes. The following day, he wore a suit and walked the streets of Rochester asking for money for a fund he created to send 2 70-year-old men to Lincoln University. And he ended up going into a bar and requesting that he wanted them to call him 250 chauffeurs to meet him at the central bank. So by all accounts, he was just kind of spouting nonsense. One of his friends saw him doing this and had him sent to the county hospital for treatment. And he received some treatment, and he left, and he was feeling better. In 1912, the family moves down to Baltimore that June, and Cab Calloway Jr. started working as a caterer. The following year, 1913, Cab Jr., Cab Calloway's father, entered the hospital again in October and died. He was 35. It still seems very inconclusive as to exactly what it was that drove him to death.
Jeez.
In the wake of that, in 1919, Cab Calloway and his mother, as well as his new stepfather, John Nelson Fortune, I like the sound of that, lived in Baltimore together in the western part of the city in a neighborhood called Druid Hill. I think this name was either changed or all of these sources are referring to Druid Hill Park, where there is now a disc golf course. In any case, John, his new stepfather, was an insurance salesman.
Sounds like a hottie.
John and Martha have 2 more children together, John and Mary Camilla. Mary Camilla is one person.
This mother is good at naming her kids. I like these names.
And good at having kids.
Apparently so. Is this 7 now?
Yeah.
God bless all the moms. I love you, Mom. She's probably not going to listen to this.
Yeah. What? How could we test your mom to see if she's listening?
Hey, Mom.
Mom,
if you hear this.
If you hear this, we will execute one of your children every hour on the hour.
No, Mom, if you hear this.
Give Owen $50.
The next time you see me, tell me a yo mama joke. Give me a yo mama joke and I'll give you a hug.
Well, that's a nice trade. Why can't all financial institutions work that way?
And Dad,
if you're listening to this,
they give you a little tap on the head.
Oh,
say, nice job, son.
Aw,
I'm proud of you.
That's so wholesome.
Now, where Cab Calloway and his family lived, it was segregated and 100% African American.
In Baltimore, yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
When Cab wasn't in school, he worked a lot. He worked for the Pimlico Race Course, which is still just outside Baltimore, where he would hose horses down in addition to shining shoes and selling the paper. Not of the horses. He was shining humans' shoes and selling humans' newspapers. The horses weren't reading the newspapers.
Bummer.
Cab also seemed to have developed a penchant for gambling, probably because he was a 12-year-old working at the racetracks, and he took to playing dice. Well, one day, his mother, Eulalia, saw him doing just that on the steps of their church. And she said, "Move into there with your hand, your uncle and Annabelle." Okay. So when Cab was 14, he was sent away to his great uncle's reform school, the Downingtown Industrial and Agricultural School, which is in Chester County, Pennsylvania.
Get out.
The Downingtown Industrial and Agricultural School was also 100% black, and it was designed for black students who were, quote, struggling in school. And they offered, quote, self-help through self-work, which is definitely not just child labor. The Downingtown branch of Delaware County Community College is now functioning in that very building. He returned back to Baltimore for his last few years at Frederick Douglass High School. While there, he played basketball and started taking vocal lessons. La, 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 la.
Cab Calloway played basketball.
He did, and as you'll see, laughing matter here. And he also worked, like his papa, as a caterer. That basketball stint led to him playing for the Baltimore Athenians, who were a professional team in the Negro Professional Basketball League, which was as good as it could get for a black person in the United States.
Wow.
Unfortunately, black people have not really taken to being good at basketball since. Cab Calloway was paid $10 a game, which is about $160 today.
Oh my gosh. Mm-hmm. Multi-talented guy.
There's a really good Baltimore Sun article that you can read all about this, which will be linked in the citation section of this episode's show notes.
Who actually reads that crap?
No one does, and I put them in Chicago-style formatting, too. Cab starts, to his parents and teachers' horror, playing not basketball, but music in jazz clubs. They view jazz as a useless pursuit and garbage music.
Wait, so what at this time did they view as good music?
Ragtime and classical.
Ragtime is awesome, though.
It is in these jazz clubs that Cab Calloway meets Chick Webb, who becomes instrumental in Cab's formulation as a performer. He taught a lot of the greats how to play.
Oh.
So 1925, Cab graduates high school. I would like to point out here that Thurgood Marshall, the justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, who was instrumental in Brown versus the Board of Education, which integrated all public school systems in 1954, graduated from that very same school that very same year. And more importantly, one Mark Andrews graduated there in 1992. You wouldn't know him by the name Mark Andrews. You know him by the name Cisco of Thong Song fame. Again, she had dumps like a all night long. Let me see that thong. In 1927, Cab's older sister, Blanche, had already dropped out of Morgan College.
Yeah, stick it to the
man.
We
love when people drop out. So Blanche dropped out of Morgan College to go into show business, baby. There is no business like it. She and Cab embark on a tour of a review called Plantation Days. Largely around Chicago. If you're not familiar of what a review was, oftentimes it was like a package of songs and performances and dances, but wasn't necessarily like a musical. You know, there wasn't inherently a through line of plot and stuff. Sometimes it was like a theme and you would have various, it was like a,
like
variety show. Yeah, a traveling variety show.
Huh.
So whilst Cab is performing and touring on Plantation Days, he gets sick. With the theater bug, baby. He loves this. He's having the time of his life, and he decides that show business is for him, and he drops out of Crane College!
Thank God.
Where he was to study law.
Over.
Cab was going to study law?
Mm-hmm. Additionally, he turns down the Harlem Globetrotters for a spot on the team.
Are you serious?
Yes. They started in 1926, the year before this. So he was going to be one of the first Harlem Globetrotters. And he said, nah, I got singing and dancing to do, man.
I mean, he made the right call, you know,
no,
in hindsight.
So Cab is playing in the cafes and clubs of Chicago. He's singing and hosting events and also playing the drums. He was a drummer as well, which I did not know until diving into this.
Hmm.
And it was here in Chicago that he meets Louis Armstrong, who got him into scat singing.
Oh, yeah.
Cab has his first child, Kamei, his daughter, who would grow up to be one of the first black teachers in a white Virginian school.
Wow.
Yeah. Kamei's mother was Zima Proctor, who Cab had met while he was in Crane College before he dropped out of there. In 1928, Cab gets married to a different woman. Yeah, poor Zima.
Gasp.
He marries Winona Betty Conacher, and they were wed in July of 1928. They would be together for 21 years and adopted a little girl named Constance together.
Wow.
Constance Calloway.
In 1929, the year of the stock market crash, Cab goes to New York City with his band, the Alabamians, which is funny because they are not from Alabama. There's not a lot written about the Alabamians because they break up almost immediately.
That sucks.
So Cab gets hired in another review entitled Connie's Hot Chocolates.
I believe in miracles.
Performing Fat Waller's Ain't Misbehavin'.
Nice. Love that song.
Me too. Love Fats Waller.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Of all the fats, ooh.
Fat Domino.
Do I like Fats Domino or Fats Waller better?
Fats Domino.
Oh.
Fats Waller is so great.
And Jitterbug Waltz.
Ugh. Mm.
Cab catches the eye of some members of a band called the Missourians.
Is this a fad back in those days?
I guess so. Like every states are there? Who ask him to sing for them, and he does. And thank Christ, they change their name to the imaginative Cab Calloway and his orchestra. So 1931, Cab Calloway and his orchestra are gigging around New York City. And they are hired to back Duke Ellington at the Cotton Club,
wow,
where you all had this sumptuous repast. The Cotton Club was sort of a mecca of jazz music in Harlem. It was a nightclub that ran for only 17 years. The Cotton Club, to me, it just felt like it was always there, you know?
Yeah, 17 years doesn't seem very long.
Yeah. Some of the most popular black jazz artists played there, ranging from Billie Holiday to Bessie Smith, Count Basie to Lena Horne.
Wow.
To Frank Sinatra.
Yes, a famous black jazz artist, Frank Sinatra. Originally, even this was a segregated club, and people with black skin were not allowed to attend the events as viewers, but eventually this did change.
That's some bullshit.
Cab Calloway and his orchestra also have a gig where each week they would go on NBC radio and play.
Nice.
And they would do this twice a week.
Wow.
Cab becomes the first African-American to have his own radio show that is nationally syndicated.
Very cool.
A Billboard article claims that he was making $50,000 a year by the time he was 23, which would be about $1.1 million today. This is the year that Cab Calloway records Minnie the Moocher, which will go on to be his calling card. Minnie the Moocher becomes so synonymous with Cab Calloway that he is often referred to as the Heidi Ho Man for the rest of his life. It sells 1 million copies, making him the first African-American to have a single that did so.
Nice.
Breaking every record. Cab Calloway's dance moves were filmed in a process called rotoscoping, where they would film Cab Calloway's over-the-top dance movements, and using a car headlamp that would blast light through individual frames of film through a projector that displayed onto tracing papers, so the animators could sketch these movements to make a much more fluid and realistic cartoon. Prior to this, cartoons were very like herky-jerky. And with this and Cab Calloway, you get really fluid-looking, chic dance moves.
I'm watching it right
now. It's on the Betty Boop.
Mm-hmm.
The Betty Boop Fleischer cartoons. And it is so smooth.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Like butter. This technology was vital in the development of cartoons and has been expanded upon to develop image capture technology, which is how CGI is created. If you've ever seen people like behind the scenes with all those different like sensors all over their body and stuff.
Like the Cats movie.
Yes. Literally, that's how this is made. It all traces back to Cab Calloway. So in Cab's case, his animated dance moves were used for 3 Betty Boop cartoons, where Cab narrated, sang, and was the basis for the dances in the episodes, entitled Minnie the Moocher, The Old Man of the Mountain, which I think is the best one, and Snow White. And yes, you can just go on YouTube and watch all 3 of these. This was far from Cab's only brush with film. He made a bunch of short films with Paramount Pictures. Ever heard of it?
No.
It has been estimated that Cab and his band appear in more films than any other of the jazz era. In 1936, his first full-length movie was The Singing Kid.
Is he the singing kid?
No, that would be Al Jolson.
Oh.
Famous blackface wearer.
Oh, God.
Which was very...
I thought that name was familiar.
Hold on, but the singing kid was actually very critical of segregation, and Al Jolson, later in his life, really came down on that practice of blackface. And in the film, Cab is a character who basically serves as the catalyst for American culture changing for the better and becoming not segregationist, and just a lot cooler. Cab recorded a ton throughout the 30s, bopping around from Brunswick to RCA Victor to Variety to Vocalion to OK Records. This brings us to our first album.
Wow, you don't say.
By Cab Calloway, which was supposedly released in 1931, but seems to have only become available in 2023 through a company called Universal Digital Enterprises, entitled Presenting Cab Calloway and His Orchestra. It's 114 tracks long.
Sure is.
And as far as I can tell, there's no like paper trail of this being out in 1931, 110 Cab Calloway songs.
No, I thought it was just like a compilation of a bunch of songs on Spotify.
It feels that way, but on Discogs, it does say that it also came out in 1931. So it's very confusing to see it in multiple places, but also having no real substantial evidence that like this would have been like 6 records to get that many songs on it.
I was going to say, do you think it was just, do you think it was like a fraction of this and then someone just added a ton of songs from that era?
That could be. Because you'll notice as you go through this record.
A lot of repeats.
A lot of repeats. But all different versions.
And every single album too.
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah.
It's like, so I wonder how many, versions there are of Minnie the Moocher. That, I mean, for real.
Yeah. And this is very much what I mean when I say it's difficult to put together a discography of Cab Calloway's, because he wasn't cutting records back then the way we think of them now. It seemed back then it was very much about quantity rather than quality. So people just made a ton of different recordings of the same songs, and sometimes they just got packaged together. This is also the era like Cab Calloway sold a million copies of just the single Minnie the Moocher.
Right.
So the single business is booming. People aren't really making records like that, you know?
Sure.
So who is, quote, his orchestra? I'm so glad you asked. It's kind of a who's who of jazz in the 1930s
who's
and 40s.
Who's Cab's orchestra?
Including folks like Dizzy Gillespie, Milt Hinton, Eddie Bearfield, and Cozy Cole.
Big names.
Got a sweater on that guy.
How about that?
He had so many members that they would play each other in baseball and basketball and even go against semi-pro teams while they were out on the road.
Are you serious?
They were pretty good.
Were they coached by Cab?
Well, he played. He was a very athletic guy.
That's awesome.
He was almost a Harlem Globetrotter at the time. Again, the record's 114 songs long, so about 10 albums worth of music. What did you guys think?
There is so much call and response on this album.
Yeah.
His voice was a lot more soothing than I remembered. I gave it a 4. I beeped when I should have bopped.
But I beat when I should have bopped. I leaped when I should have lopped. I was walking on air till she called me a square. Cause I beeped when I should have bopped. I dipped when I should have flipped. I tripped when I should have hipped.
That's a great title, isn't it? I beeped when I should have bopped.
Hot Water was a jam. I loved Gotta Go Places. I thought that was a total little earworm with relatable lyrics.
I gotta go places, I gotta see things. See new faces and brand new things. Gotta go places and do things. Maybe to forget you.
Like, I've noticed this about a lot of his songs. So, like, obviously a lot of the songs that he does are, like, jazz standards, right? Like, he didn't write them. Mm. But some of the songs he did write, like Minnie the Moocher, he co-wrote. Mm. And the song The Lady with the Fan is, like, such a hilarious example of him just, like, being obsessed with these characters that he creates in his songs and then constantly references them in multiple songs.
Oh, yeah.
Like, in Lady with the Fan, he references the Ghost of Smokey Joe. Mm-hmm. In the Ghost of Smokey Joe, he references Minnie the Moocher. Like, they're constantly, and we'll say, like, sometimes he'll compare them. Like, they're competing. I don't know. It cracks me up.
I did not know that there is a sequel to Minnie the Moocher entitled Minnie the Moocher's Wedding Day.
Yeah, that was wild.
Whenever folks in Chinatown start acting gay, there's something in the air that makes them feel that way. Yeah, man, I heard somebody. somebody say, it's Minnie the Moocher's wedding day. Old Smokey Joe's so happy he could hardly wait. He spent $1 million for his wedding cake. Yeah, man, they're gonna celebrate. It's Minnie the Moocher's wedding day. You better come on down.
You better come on down.
He talks about Chinatown a lot through his music. It seems to be something he's really fixated on.
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure why.
I think I am.
Oh.
That is where you would go to get drugs.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense for a lot of his music.
Mm-hmm.
I hated I Should Have Beeped When I Bopped.
Really?
That was my least favorite song and is my yucky icky song.
Whoa.
When I heard it, I was so irritated by it. Almost immediately, I turned it off.
Mm. I beep when I should have bopped. And I meep when I should have bopped.
And normally, I think Cab's little eccentricities are like what makes him so great. But man, that song, that to me is like if a Cab Calloway hater would like show that song and think that that's all he does.
So he gooped and you whooped.
Yeah. Got it. Big time.
I wrote that I beeped when I should have bopped is an incredible title and a shitty song. But Geek Squad's marketing should do something with that. Yeah, he seems to just mess around on a lot of his songs as well. Take Nagasaki, for example, where he's just like, he's making himself laugh. Like, he's just cracking himself up on a lot of these.
Which I love that. Like, that's super. And I think that his energy and his joy really shines through a lot of these albums and a lot of these songs.
Sure.
I mean, I love the call and response things. I like that more in other albums, actually. And I just like the whole vibe of this album. Mm. Like, I feel like you could just kind of put it on and, I don't know, forget it's on, but in like a good way. Like, it's great background music if you're into that type of like, you know, big jazzy, old-timey type of music.
Sure.
Swing it, swing it, you dog. Come on in there now. You mug inside your mom. Get away from there.
My Yuck Icky song was on this album, and it was Minnie the Moocher. Probably just because I've heard it a bunch of times, and it's kind of boring.
That is so bold of you to go with Minnie the Moocher as Cab Calloway's worst song.
Out of all of the Cab Calloway, it's just not the kind of Cab Calloway I like.
Hmm.
Ooh.
With this next album, and the next like two or three, that's where it's like perfect.
Oh.
All right. He covers so much stuff and really surprises me with a lot of it. For example, the track Reefer Man, I think would surprise a lot of people that, you know, in 1931, there's a song called Reefer Man.
Mm-hmm.
The drug use that comes around on here, like kicking the gong around.
Oh, yeah.
That's also where you see Minnie the Moocher again, like these recurring characters and drug references.
He's all about, I mean, he says the word cokies like a million times.
Yep. I have to say, some of my favorite songs on here were the instrumentals. I think his band is fantastic. I really liked Rail Rhythm. It's quintessentially this era. I liked most of the music on these songs, unfortunately, and it really pains me to say, I think Cab's delivery kind of ruins it sometimes.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have examples?
Yes, if you look at the song Peckin'.
You talk about your truckin' when the peckin' is new. Well, here's a dance that you all should do. You get way low down to the floor, and if you peck once, you'll peck twice, you'll peck it some more. You peck to the front, to the side, and to the back. Well, look at old Gibby's pecking on his back. Pecking to me is you pick one and I'll pick one. Well, we'll all pick one.
Yeah, so that sucks.
You're so picky.
That's a strong opinion. Is that your Yuck Icky song?
No.
Oh, I'm so excited to hear your opinions on that.
It's just an example. It just seems to me like the band's trying really hard, and he's like, ah, but like, it feels so mailed into me.
Whatever, dude.
I like his charisma.
I think that's a lack of charisma on that
song. Someone
doesn't
have
it when he's being charismatic.
Much riz.
I mean, to be fair, that's kind of how I feel on I Beeped When I Should Have Bopped. Mm-hmm. When he goes, I'm like...
Go ahead. Let's hear it.
I meh when I should have meh. Like, the way he says that second one is really irritating to me.
In 1938, Cab becomes the first African-American to publish a dictionary. This was entitled Cab Calloway's Catalogue, a Hepster's Dictionary. He released new editions of this dictionary up until 1944. Lem Sisse, a British author and the official poet of the 2012 London Olympics, said that with the dictionary, quote, Cab Calloway was taking ownership of language for a people who, just a few generations before, had their own languages taken away. Which I think is an interesting way of looking at it and really contextualizes the fact that, you know, Cab Calloway is only separated by 60 years. I mean, he was literally born, 40 years after the Civil War.
That's wild to think about.
In 1941, the year that the United States was attacked in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii by the Japanese, Cab and his orchestra were playing in Harlem when trumpeter Jonah Jones popped a ball of paper into his mouth, got it nice and wet, took it out, and threw it at Cab Calloway behind his back during the show. After the show, when the curtains closed on the band, Cab Calloway was pissed, and he runs immediately up to Dizzy Gillespie, who had a reputation for being a prankster in the band. And Dizzy Gillespie is like, it wasn't me, man. Well, the issue was, according to Alan Shipton's excellent book on Dizzy Gillespie, which I used extensively for this episode, called Groovin' High, The Life of Dizzy Gillespie, Dizzy didn't do it. And everyone knew that. But Cab didn't know that, and Cab could not be convinced. So they start fighting, and Dizzy Gillespie pulls out a knife and drives it into Cab Calloway's leg.
Oh my God, he actually stabbed him?
He stabs Cab Calloway over this.
I knew that he got a knife pulled on him by Dizzy. I did not think that there was actual, like, physical harm done. I thought it was just a threat.
Well, Dizzy said, quote, when Cab got to his dressing room, he found his beautiful white suit had red all the way down the pants. Dizzy was immediately fired from the band.
Sounds like Dizzy beeped.
Cab-bopped. They did make up before they both passed away.
Oh my God, it took that long?
Yes. And Dizzy Gillespie said of Cab Calloway, quote, discipline. That's the word with no deviations from it. Working in his band taught me to do what I was supposed to do. So Dizzy, even through this experience that drove him to knifing his band leader, still found, you know, positive things that he garnered from being in Cab's band. 1942. Cab's career took something of a hit during a musician's strike that lasted the better part of 2 years, as members of the American Federation of Musicians were barred from making recordings with commercial record labels. Now, the strike was initiated due to a conflict between the union and record companies regarding royalty payments. This is still the longest lasting strike in the entertainment industry ever.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Almost 2 years. Cab was still allowed to play concerts and go on the radio and such, so he busied himself by going overseas to play for American soldiers in World War II, regaling them with topical songs he wrote, such as The Fuhrer's Got the Jitters and My Lament for V-Day.
Oh, the Fuhrer's got the jitters and the Fuhrer's looking thin. We have made our reservations and he knows we're moving in. Oh, the Fuhrer's got the jitters and the Fuhrer's looking thin. We have made our reservations and he knows we're moving in. Now, just a hint that we'll be there.
Now, during the strike, Cab goes back into the movies because he's allowed to be in the movies. And he is in a film called
Stormy Weather, which is a musical film starring a predominantly black cast, including Lena Horne, who, this is interesting, got her start as a dancer in a short film nearly a decade prior entitled Cab Calloway's Jitterbug Party.
How about that?
Yeah.
Would highly recommend anybody go on YouTube and watch the closing number of Stormy Weather with the Nicholas Brothers.
Yes. Yeah.
There's a whole dance. So Cab Calloway is singing. Is he like hip, 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 jump and jive?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he's like going crazy and his band's on fire. And then the Nicholas Brothers does this dance scene. I watched it earlier to kind of prep myself for this episode. And it like, every time I watch it makes my heart like, it almost gives me anxiety with how good it is. Especially when they do the splits down the steps is like one of the most insane things I've ever seen anybody do. Like in like a dancing medium.
The band gets back to work at the end of the strike and resumed recording and touring. And according to an article by NPR, Cab Calloway made a series of bad financial choices after the strike with the band's money, which seemed to have bankrolled his gambling habit, and before the decade was over, his band was dissolved and they were all pissed at him.
That sucks.
It sounds like he gambled with the band's money. Okay. 1945, Cab is beaten and arrested outside of the Playmore Ballroom in Kansas City, Missouri, by Officer William E. Todd. Cab and his pal Felix Payne Jr. wanted to see their friend Lionel Hampton, who was playing a show at the Playmore Ballroom that night. Hampton found out that this had happened and stopped the concert while it was happening in protest. Officer Todd claimed that Cab and Felix were drunk and booked them on that, as well as resisting arrest. All charges were dismissed, and the NAACP fought to have Todd fired, but he quit anyway after his pay was reduced. 1945, the United States defeat the Japanese, the Germans, and those spaghetti-faced motherfucker-eating, parmesan-sipping, bolognese-slurping, ravioli-derping, eye ties.
Right, dude. Put her there.
1949, Cab remarries just a few months after he and Betty divorce.
Damn, scandalous. Mm.
Scandalous.
His new bride, who he will remain married to for the rest of his life, 45 years, more to go. Mm. Was named Nuffy.
Nuffy?
Nuffy McNeil.
Nice. That's a good name. That's like a storybook name.
They raised their family in Westchester, New York. You know, just a little bit outside of New York City. Yeehaw! Ride 'em, cowboy! And they had three daughters together. Chris, Cecilia, who went by the name Lael. L-A-E-L,
okay.
Who is still alive at the time of recording, and Cabella, which is Cab, but feminized.
Oh.
That's that fish shop, right?
Yeah. So Chris and Cabella both have passed. Cabella died just last year in
2023. Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. In the arms of an angel.
1952, Cab has another run-in with the police in Leesburg, Virginia.
Whoop, whoop.
He was caught doing 65 miles per hour, speeding to visit a raceway in West Virginia. State Trooper Roy S. Smith was offered $10 by Cab Calloway to get out of it. And subsequently, Roy S. Smith took Cab to jail and hit him with a $500 bond.
Damn. Cab's charm, I guess, didn't work on him.
Nope. The following year, 1953, never one to sit around for too long, Cab was cast as the character Sportin' Life in George Gershwin's Porgy and Bess.
Right.
It ain't necessarily so. It ain't necessarily so. Things that the preacher is liable to teach you, it ain't necessarily so.
1956, Cab breaks onto the Billboard Hot 100 at number 62 with his single Little Child, which he recorded with his daughter, Leo.
That's cute.
Yeah. literally a little child singing Little Child? Come on!
Little one, yes, the world's really round, and the bluebirds you search for will surely be found, and the sky up above is so blue and clear, so that you see the blue.
The same year, a gentleman named Clarence Robinson contacted Cab. They had worked together at the clubs of Harlem, and he was the choreographer for the film Stormy Weather. Robinson proposed to Cab, here comes the bride, that Cab should serve as the featured component of his newest enterprise, the Cotton Club of Miami.
Whoa.
Mm-hmm. And Cab agreed, and it was a hit. They put together a review that started at the club in Miami, and it eventually got so popular, they took it on a tour all over the country before eventually traveling as far as South America and Europe with that same review. Wow. Cab put out a record of this review called Cotton Club Review of 1958. In 1958, Cab was in the picture St. Louis Blues alongside Eartha Kitt and Nat King Cole.
Mm.
It's kind of like the next generation of jazz-adjacent black performers.
Mm.
1959, the record entitled Heidi, Heidi, Ho comes out.
Oh boy.
The second record for what we're calling Cab's discography.
So I gave this one a 5.5.
Mm-hmm.
I liked it a lot more than the first one.
It's certainly shorter.
Which is a huge plus. This one felt more meaningful and like he was like writing songs, like kind of more as songs and not ideas, which I kind of felt like that was a big thing on the first one. It's home to my yummy, yummy song, I'll Be Around, which I thought was really nice and pleasant.
Lose me, your latest love can never last. And when it's past, I'll be around when he's gone.
I'll be around, my dear.
Goodbye.
I really did not like this album.
Whoa.
I really didn't like this album. I found his voice very put on and schmoozy in a way that seemed very fake to me. And just like, I thought that a lot of the versions of his songs, particularly Minnie the Moocher and St. James Infirmary, were very watered down versions of his songs. Except he does hit that real wicked low note in this version of Minnie the Moocher. I don't like how clean cut the band sounds. I liked the grit, grainy and kind of rawness of the back and forth of the previous record and of the records to come. I thought that a lot of the songs sounded like Frank Sinatra arrangements, but like not in a good way.
Mm.
And yeah, man, I just really didn't like it. I gave it a 3. The standout track is It Ain't Necessarily So, for me, because...
Isn't that a Weezer song?
The song is home to my Yummy Yummy track, which is entitled The Jumpin' Jive, Hep Hep. To me, it's just so much fun. I think it's Cab Calloway at his best, where he seems to be enjoying himself, but it also is like reined in enough that it doesn't feel too over the top. He's just a fun performer. To me, this feels like his wheelhouse.
Once my boy, take a sweater down. Oh boy!
Gotta take a
Can't you hear those hip cats call? Come on, boys, let's have a ball. The Jim Jam Jump is a jumping jive. Makes you dig your kicks on the mellow side. A hip hip. A hip hip. The Jim Jam Jump is a solid jive. Makes you 9 foot tall when you 4 foot five. A hip hip. Hip, hip.
I love that song. I do not like the version. Again, I feel like it's water. I think the calmness to me feels watered down because he's so peppy. And he's singing lower. Mm-hmm. And again, I don't like he's such a tenor. And like he has this register that I think he just shines in. And sure. It's clear that he shines in it because he sings in it all the time. Mm-hmm. And I felt like on this he was trying something like a different type, like accessing a different type of voice. And it didn't work for me.
Interesting.
But
interesting.
Yeah.
This is me.
Cab is 52 at this point.
Damn.
Jesus.
So, you know, we didn't really talk about it, but if that is a compilation album from the 30s, you know, that's kind of young Cab Calloway. Now we get him starting to move into his more advanced years. And I do think you hear a lot, as you were saying, in the production quality, for better or for worse. Some people might have liked that. Some people prefer the grit that you did on the older albums. But also his voice is changing. So 1961, Cab continues working on TV and touring. He also begins working with the Harlem Globetrotters. And at long last, he starts doing their halftime show.
Are you serious?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh, he goes, aw. They never forgot him.
They never.
He's the one that got away.
In 1965, in the latter half of the decade, Cab takes to the screen and stage, appearing in The Cincinnati Kid and getting cast in the likes of Hello, Dolly, as well as The Pajama Game on Broadway. Well, Sarah, I imagine you'll like this record because in 1965, Cab Calloway puts out his third record of what we're calling his discography, entitled Let's Swing. And it does seem to be a compilation record from Days of Yore, because the sound quality is terrible on this. It's super quiet and grainy, and I do really like it.
Yeah.
This album's also only 13 songs long.
I gave this album a 5.5 again. The band was cooking on this one. There are a lot of tasty licks, a lot of fun licks that go on and keep returning. Just a lot of energy. I like it. 5.5. Boom. Slap it on there. Good stuff. Good job, boys.
Yeah, out of the 13 songs, a bunch of them are instrumentals, and I think his band's always good, so I think the instrumentals are always great.
Yeah, yeah. I just said, back to the classic Cab voice.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And I said that I quite liked the old Black Magic version that he does in this.
Love that song.
Yeah. I've heard a lot of versions, and I like this one. It's definitely, I forget, there's someone, oh my God, I think it was Bing Crosby does a version that I just absolutely detest.
I like Google more.
And every time your lips meet mine, darling, down, down I go, around and round I go, in a spin, loving the spin that I'm in. That old black magic called love. That old black magic called love.
Owen's lyric of the day, or episode, or whatever you want to call it, comes from "Everybody Eats When They Come to My House." Mm-hmm. Have a banana, Hannah. Try the salami, Tommy. Go with the gravy, Davy. Everybody eats when they come to my house. Try a tomato, Plato. Here's...
Come on. He's not having anyone named Plato come to his house.
Taste the bologna, Tony. Everybody eats when they come to my house.
I don't like that song very much.
No, it sucks.
I think it's rather irritating.
Yeah. But he seemed to think it was the best thing he ever did.
Yeah, it's... I've heard it like several times.
Anna.
Who wrote that? I bet he didn't write that.
I bet he did.
I bet he did.
Think so? Let's see. Oh, you're right. It's by Cab.
Have a banana, Hannah. Try the salami, Tommy. Give it to gravy, Davy. Everybody eats when they come to my house. Try a tomato plate too. Here's catch a Tori Dory. Taste the bologna, Tony. Everybody eats when they come to my house. I fix your.
In 1976, Cab seems to have started taking it easy, now entering his 70s. He writes his autobiography entitled Of Minnie the Moocher and Me.
And speaking of that title, just a few years later, he puts out the disco edition of Minnie the Moocher, which hits 91 on the Billboard R&B chart.
And apparently he was really pissed with the Blues Brothers when they didn't choose this version in the movie.
Smoking. She loved him, though he was cooking. He took her down to Chinatown. He showed her how to kick the gong around. Hidey, 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 hidey. Yeah. Hidey, hidey, hidey,
hidey. In 1980, he'll take that song to the Dan Aykroyd John Belushi joint, the Blues Brothers, which produced New Interest in Cab Calloway and gave his career a second wind.
And again, apparently he really, really wanted like an upbeat version of Minnie the Moocher, and they like said that he had to do like a slow down version, and he got real, real mad and like stormed off set. Mm. And then he came back and performed like nothing happened.
Well, 1978, the world gets Singin' and Swingin'. Woo! Again, I suspect it's probably a compilation album of years past. This album's very confusing. It's 12 songs long, and it feels like some of it is recorded live and others aren't. They do this weird thing where there's a narrator for this record, which is something I haven't really heard before.
Yeah, it was kind of neat.
Yeah. I've got a lot of vinyl from the 70s, and I've never heard this one.
I think it was trying to sound like a live radio show.
Yeah. So I think they're playing the recordings and then adding a live audience track. And then just having this guy narrate over it, because I think I actually have heard some of these other versions on other albums of his.
Okay.
So I think they are recycling stuff and then just trying to make it seem like this live performance.
One Night Stand presents the King of Hidey Ho, Cab Calloway and his orchestra.
You guessed it, the theme is Minnie the Moocher. And the orchestra, well, it's Cab Calloway, His Highness of Hidey Ho, and his orchestra, playing for your dancing and listening pleasure at the new Zanzibar, Broadway and 49th Street in New York City.
I, for one, absolutely love this album. I gave it a 7.5. Something about it, like the some songs like Afternoon Moon, mm-hmm. It seems like so like Elvis and Lost. Like there's something about it that seems like so perfect and kind of like dramatic and like cinematic almost. It kind of paints a picture, and I love it so much.
Wish me success. You hope and pray that she will say yes. I can't wish upon a lucky star. It's much too soon. So be my lucky afternoon.
I also loved it a lot. It said it's like the standard cab sound, but like Ida's best. Mm. And I said Afternoon Moon is like good schmoozy cab, whereas that one album was like bad schmoozy. I really love the call and responses from the rest of his orchestra, because they like, you know, I like that some of them are a little off key. I think it sounds really real. I think it sounds really communal. Actually, and that's what I wrote for the next album, not to jump ahead, but like there's just this communal sound. You know, Cab Calloway, I think, is a formidable talent. And then when he, like, has these background vocals, it reminds you that, like, anybody can sing along to it. Mm-hmm. It's, like, doesn't feel so far above anybody else.
Sure.
And I like that a lot.
Jesse, hey now, hey now.
Here's an attractive promise, as Cab Calloway says, we the cat shall help you.
To me, this is a guy who just is loving every minute of what he's doing, and that's why I love this album so much. And he, I think, at his best is so infectious.
Yes.
When he's dancing on stage, he's got that giant smile on his face, and it's like, how could you not just like laugh and smile while watching this guy? He's a party. He's a one-man party.
Well, I didn't really exactly choose Cab Calloway because I loved his music.
He chose you.
I chose him because, like, you just have to watch him perform for 5 seconds on, like, a YouTube video at his prime to be like, oh my god, like, who is this guy? And how come no one talks about him? Like, obviously people do, but, like, you know, I didn't discover Cab Calloway until a local band covered my Yummy Yummy song, which actually is not on any of these albums, which is The Ghost of Smokey Joe.
Remember when I kicked the bucket in my mansion up on Stryver's Row? When they came and took me off in a $1 zillion coffin, 'cause I'm the ghost of Smokey Joe. Tell me, do you remember Minnie?
Yeah, we remember Minnie.
That frail I never found. You never recognize your Minnie. You mean to say that Minnie quit kicking the gong around?
And one of my friend's bands covered it, and I didn't know who he was. And they said it was Cab Calloway, and that's how I found out about him. I'd never heard of him before. I'd never seen anybody like him, but everybody tries to imitate him. Mm. You know?
Whether they know it or not.
Mm-hmm.
Is this legal? Picking a Yummy Yummy song that is not featured on the albums?
No, that's illegal.
Okay.
You're going 500 years dungeon.
Yeah.
1985, Cab plays a few shows in the US and UK, several of which were recorded and filmed in the 1990s. So he's like, you know, 80 years old at that point.
But he's old in the Blues Brothers.
Yeah.
He's like ancient.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know.
Well, he's still not done. In 1990, he appears in Janet Jackson's music video for her song, All Right.
He sure does. So do the Nicholas Brothers.
Yeah.
And he's in that like gold suit.
Mm-hmm.
It's great.
It's hard to keep a good man down. You know?
He's a star in that music video.
This might have been the apex of his career and, you know, kind of on the decline here. Because 4 years later, Cab has a stroke on June 12th at his house. His health would continue declining, resulting in his placement in a nursing home. I suspect that this would be this could be a typo or simply an incorrect attribution. But this record, Are You Hep to the Jive, says it came out on August 9th of 1994. And that's going to be the last album which we analyze of Cab Calloway's. It's got 22 tracks. Definitely feels much more like a compilation record.
5.5. What's new? I like Boo Wah. That's really it.
Swing it soon. You can chime in on the jive, jive, jive.
Ooh-wah-wah-wah.
It's a simple rhythm.
Ooh-wah-wah-wah.
Ooh, with an easy lift.
Ooh-wah-wah-wah-wah.
That's the rhythm of the jive, jive, jive. You have to dig this tempo.
Fun to say, and it's
a good song.
A good song. I don't know what else you want from me, man.
I loved this album. Mm-hmm. I gave it a 6. Are You Hep to the Jive? This version I liked a lot. And the Calloway Boogie, I really, really enjoyed.
Yeah.
And kind of the same thing I said about the last one is that it just feels like the energy is real high. He sounds like he's having his good time. The band sounds like they're having a good time. And his vocals just really shine. He's such a tenor.
This, I think, is some of the most campy songs he ever wrote. That don't really seem to have any sort of meaning. It's just kind of like funny situations that he thought of. Like, Papa's in bed with his britches on. Or, oh, Grandpa, which is just about how horny this kid's grandpa is.
Wait, what?
Yeah, I think that went over Owen and I's heads for some reason.
Oh, Grandpa, you got home at 2:30? Grandma salty and mad at you. Oh, Grandpa, look out, look out, look out, look out. You said you was going up to the lodge. Well, Grandma's onto that trick. You better learn the art of duck and dodge, 'cause Grandma saw you with a real young chick. Oh,
Grandpa. Get some wings and fly real high, 'cause Grandma.
And by this point, I really hated Everybody Eats When They Come to My House. I was totally over it, hearing it for the eighth time. On November 18th, when Cab Calloway is 86 years old, he passes away from pneumonia. Mm. His grandson, Chris Calloway Brooks, one of Cab's seven grandsons, put together the Cab Calloway Orchestra, playing his grandfather's songs, many of which were first performed over half a century earlier. In 2012, PBS did an episode of American Masters, strictly about Cab Calloway. 2019, the city of Baltimore announced that it was going to demolish 2216 Druid Hill Ave, where Cab grew up, as well as all the adjoining houses. The city intended to build a park here named after Cab, and this has led to a massive fight that has been going on for years. The National Trust for Historic Preservation did not like this idea, and obviously neither did Cab Calloway's descendants, who had fought tooth and nail to make sure that this did not happen. However, all told, on September 5th, 2020, in the dead of a global pandemic, that house was destroyed, and all the adjoining houses.
Wow.
As of 2023, the Baltimore City Department of Planning posted on February 23rd, so just about a year ago, that it has completed the removal of every last structure that was present on the 14,000 feet of where this park will eventually exist. And that's kind of it. There's no park there right now. There's just a lot of empty land after they destroyed everything near it.
Each episode, we like to highlight the up-and-coming work of a discography-developing diva. Today, that is Pose Norma. Pose Norma is the musical project of Sarah, who is our guest right now, baby. It is now time to want it. Oh, you can have it. You can have it. If you need it, you better believe in something. We can make it. Oh, if you want it, you can have it. Ah. With Pose Norma and her track, Cry, Cry, Cry.
All I do is cry about the weather. All I do is cry about my potential place in this world. I do is cry about how much you mean to me, even though there's nothing wrong between us.
Cry about it.
hear more from Pose Norma, listen to a playlist of our favorite Cab Calloway songs, visit our shop and social media pages, contact us, view our citations, and so much more by using the links in this episode's show notes.
Well, I think Timothy White of Billboard summed it up best in 1993 when he said, quote, "No living pathfinder in American popular music or its jazz and rock and roll capillaries is so frequently emulated, yet so seldom acknowledged as Cabell Cab Calloway. He arguably did more things first and better than any other bandleader of his generation."
Amen.
Amen.
"For he's a jolly good fellow.
For he's a jolly good fellow. For he's a jolly good fellow. Which nobody can deny."
Good job, Cab.